Hello, and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where at first Hollywood was delighted to see someone other than Disney succeed at the box office. But suddenly, the other studios aren't finding Joker's success so funny, because both Disney and Sony found their long gestating sequels, 5 and 10 years respectively, seriously undercut by Joker's unexpected staying power, which again fell under 50%. Joker is indeed taking his sweet time working his way down those box office stairs, and in 3 weeks has already gone way past 700 million worldwide. It's so exciting, but again, not for the other studios. They're like, can't we just all kind of win for once? Why does it have to be just one studio? I mean, it's very competitive. It's a very crowded release slate for the rest of the year. And it's hard for movies to find space, as you're going to see, because one other problem is that the weekend was just too damn crowded. But anyway, interestingly, it's the overseas box office that's really propelling Joker's fortunes at almost 70%. And in fact, if you look at the domestic list for all-time R-rated movies, Joker is still a long way from the top and will likely never get there. Worldwide, though, he is in striking distance of Deadpool, both of which, by the way, climbed to such heights without China. But it's worth noting that with China, both might have made it into the billion-dollar club. That's right! I'm still not sure the Joker is going to make it into that hallowed circle. That's because it is slowing down, and it has no countries left to go. That means there's no pockets of cash left to count on. Often when we talk about, like for instance, remember we argued about Spider-Man for a really long time? But it still had China waiting further off in its web. And sure enough, China really helped Spider-Man Homecoming. Far From Home. China helps a lot of movies. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood just got shit out of China, and that was going to take it to 400 million, and which would have benefited how the film looks on paper. And I think it underscores the Bruce Lee controversy, as I talked about on the member stream today, which is going to hurt with awards, which is good. I mean, this is a controversial year for the awards. I mean, Joker, Jojo Rabbit, Parasite is a very edgy movie, apparently. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I guess it's a reflection of the times that we're in, which I do find very interesting. If Deadpool and Joker had released in China, maybe they would have made $1 billion. But all Joker really has to do, don't worry, it would be nice if it got into the billion-dollar club, but it doesn't need to do that. All it needs to do is pass up Deadpool, again, to be the highest R-rated movie worldwide, and I think it's likely going to do that. Personally, at this rate, I would peg Joker at ending up somewhere around the 900 million mark, which would be amazing! And I can't wait to see how the super savvy Ryan Reynolds makes the most of the situation on social media. Will he do like a picture, a video? I think he'll do something really fun. He's so smart! And again, what really puts a smile on Warner Brothers' face is that Joker is performing alongside these blockbuster films at a fraction of the price. But back to Ryan Reynolds. Joker and Deadpool do basically have the same budget. And Deadpool itself was nominated, as you might recall, for 2 major Golden Globes, Best Picture, Musical or Comedy, and Best Actor, Musical or Comedy. Didn't make it to the Oscars, but I think that's definitely Joker's next battle, awards season. And other films like Mad Max and Black Panther have done well at the Oscars, but what we're looking for with Joker specifically is major nominations and wins. Specifically, I think picture, director, actor and screenplay. And I think it's gonna get there, at least the nominations. And I would think it would probably win one of those categories because the Academy Awards try to be pretty democratic. And there's heat. The Joker has very good people working on it who I think are well, beyond Todd Phillips. I'm talking like producers and stuff. At some of the events I've been attending, I hear positive buzz for the film. Now, despite what Francis Ford Coppola and Martin Scorsese might be saying, I told you, I think it's personal for Scorsese. He's like, if I get beat for The Irishman by a film that's copying me, I'm going to be really annoyed. But I think that's what's going to happen. All right, so as for the weekend's new releases, they both underperformed, not just because of Joker, although that was a big part of it, but also because when their first installments opened, they were the only big releases of their weekend. But in 2019, both Maleficent 2 and Zombieland 2 ended up splitting what was left of audiences not seeing Joker. It also seems that Angelina Jolie needs to rebuild her audience, which was pretty spotty to begin with. She's always been more of a tabloid star. She sells, you know, gossip magazines and gets people to click rather than pay for a movie ticket. That's always been the situation with her. And there are a lot of actors, but there are some actors, but that's what they do. But anyway, Jolie not only took a break to try and launch a directing career, as you might recall, which didn't work out, but in 2016, she and Brad Pitt, of course, had that infamous incident on a private plane, which led to the very public ending of their marriage and family. And the personal toll, understandably, sidelined both of them. It was a PR disaster. I think emotionally, it obviously was very difficult. And, you know, it takes a lot of work to detangle. I mean, they'd gotten married finally, right? It takes a lot of work to detangle the situation financially and also in terms of visitation for the kids. That's a big ball of string. Soaked in tears. I think Brad Pitt was very sad. I think that Angelina Jolie came out, you know, she's tried to play the press before and usually wins. Although, of course, there's still people who are Team Aniston. But I think that she came out looking like the villain with Brad Pitt. And interestingly, they're both trying to stage comebacks this year. Pitt is doing a tad better. I think that Ad Astra kind of cancels out Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And Once Upon a Time in Hollywood also, of course, is a very controversial film. But then, of course, Jolie is set to join the MCU, so that could give her a major boost. Now, back to Disney. They also tried to pass off a spring movie as a Halloween movie and paid the price, just as they did for releasing a Christmas movie at the very beginning of November, right? If your movie's so reliant on a season, you gotta release during that season. It also seems that audiences can tell when Disney is making a real effort and when they're just phoning it in. But even when Disney loses, they win, because these films will still do very well in the ancillary market. Maleficent 2 got an A cinema score, and it will be a boon to Disney Plus, which needs content, content, content. That's the name of the game. They want you to feel that you can watch their service exclusively forever. And, well, to me, I think it's the sameness of the content that will be a problem for Disney, because they have such a specific brand, whereas Netflix is going to experiment with all kinds of genres. But I think, you know, how much sugar can you eat? A spoonful of sugar every day? I don't know. That might make you barf and click on another streaming service. All right, so as for Zombieland 2, in addition to the proliferation of zombie fare since the first film, another problem seems to be lack of diversity, because 51% Caucasian is unusually high these days. Sure, Rosario Dawson joined the cast, but in a small supporting role. And in 2019, can you really have four white leads and expect big box office? Zoe Deutsch is so good in the movie, I would keep her. But perhaps another character of color with a larger role, and maybe a male character, as the sequel is already very female heavy, should have been added. Two awards hopefuls also hit the specialty market, but also underperformed. Neither Jojo Rabbit nor The Lighthouse, supposedly hot titles, could come close to either Parasite or The Farewell's opening weekend per theater averages, the ones to beat this year. The Lighthouse was in 8 theaters, so that diluted it a bit, but in just 5 theaters, and with supposedly strong online support, Jojo Rabbit should have opened stronger. We'll see how Jojo Rabbit does in the long run. But that lack of interest, that should have been a hot title. That was the audience award winner at TIFF. It's supposed to be an Oscar frontrunner. It opened in New York and Los Angeles. Those are the communities that need to support that film. And if they weren't interested in going to see it, I don't think that bodes well for how the film will do in the middle of the country. But that, I mean, maybe people will feel sorry for it in the industry, and that'll help its awards chances. Taika Waititi can squeeze out a few tears. Say it's a hate campaign from, I'd say for the most part, the media has been very supportive of the movie, wrongfully so. All right, so anyway, although I have to say, a number of major, major publications have given it a bad review, despite some of you trying to skew the conversation. I mean, as you saw, I think all the big trade, most of the trades gave it a bad review, Vanity Fair, Wall Street Journal, you know, big publications, negative, you know, Rotten Tomato. And me. All right, so, but Parasite added 30 theaters this weekend and is getting very close to the top 10. And it still boasted a very strong per theater average, especially for 33 theaters. Last night, I went to see Zombieland 2 again. I took my parents. And they played a trailer in front of that movie for Parasite. And it's very unusual to see a foreign language film advertised in front of a mainstream release. Could Parasite become a mainstream hit? If it does, that would be a major feather in the cap of newbie distributor Neon, who nobody's really heard of. And I have to say, the fact they're able to book really strong theaters for this, considering the fact they don't have, I mean, distributors have relationships with theater chains, and it's hard for a new one to get territory, so to speak. So I think that a lot of what's benefiting Parasite is that can win, and then also Bong Joon-ho and the very strong reviews. It's a hot ticket, and what theater owner doesn't like to make some money? It is selling out still everywhere, pretty much everywhere it plays. All right, so as for the overall top 10, Gemini Man suffered the biggest drop in only its second weekend, whereas Junie continues to draw some interest with the smallest drop a month out. Then the Addams Family didn't enjoy a strong hold as the first two Hotel Transylvania movies, also released in October, which fell only in the 30th percentile, low 30th percentile in their second weekends. But still, Addams Family had a solid hold and likely stole some family audiences away from Maleficent 2 and even Zombieland 2. There was a family in my screening last night. As for this coming weekend, with weak new entries, it's a good time for everyone to make some extra money before Terminator Dark Fate hits November 1st. Are you planning to... It's weird. You know, that should be a Halloween weekend because the movies start on Thursday night, which of course is Halloween. So you would... I don't know. I would thought some Halloween movie would have tried to maybe get in there. And there's no Halloween movie... Oh, there's a horror movie opening this Friday. So maybe that. So are you planning to see a new release this coming weekend? Are you going to circle back and check something out that's already playing for the first time, the second, or maybe the gabillionth time, Joker fans? Or are you just going to, at this point, wait for Terminator? Share your thoughts down below. That's this week's movie math. As always, thanks for going over the box office with me. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.